So just to kick this off, Anne had just recently introduced herself, and we're going to get into a little bit more of the projects there, just to make sure that we have on the record here. This is for the broader IOI steering committee team and for our funders at Sloan to kind of share out the work in progress, because I know that Teri and Anne are still wrapping up some final approvals, and especially for Teri, who's got some interviews that he's following up on for review from the participants, not to be distributed more broadly at this time, that we'll be making those results open in the beginning of January. Okay, Teri, would you like to introduce yourself as well?
Yes, thank you, Katie. Hello, everyone. My name is Teri Wanderi, and I am an aspiring researcher from Nairobi, Kenya. I've spent most of my time doing solutions architect work. So just telling people what kind of technology they could use, how to structure it if they're building apps, building systems. I did some work in research, maybe familiar with the company, Nielsen. So here it's just called Nielsen. So not like Nielsen Media or tracking like in the US. They mostly do market research. So it's door-to-door questions, interviews, doing stock taking in the supermarkets, just trying to figure out how best to monetize like their presence around customers. So that's what I spend most of my time on. Like when I'm not doing research, I'm helping people build apps, or I'm helping people figure out how to digitize their businesses, because we have this whole push on digital transformation that the president of Kenya decided to go for in his last election speech. So that's what keeps me busy when I'm not looking at the amazing work from the very talented people at IOI. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much. So for the frame of this, we've kind of told Anne and Teri that we'll be giving them 15 minutes to talk through and share out with us their work to date, and then we'll have the rest open for discussion. If you have any questions while they're giving their presentations, please feel free to drop them in the chat and we'll do our best to sort of moderate that. And would you like to kick things off? Over to you.
Everybody can see this? Okay, so my study for 8 weeks looked at Wikidata. And because IOI is interested in understanding the landscape of open infrastructure and the investments in it, and they're interested in doing it in a transparent way, I thought Wikidata might be a possible solution for a way to sort of map understandings of basic facts about open infrastructure and its funding. So for those of you who don't know, Wikidata is a sister project of Wikipedia, and it started in 2012. It's grown really quickly and now has about 96 million data items in it. And just like Wikipedia, it's multilingual. Anybody can edit it. It's free to use. It's open source. It's easy to reuse. And it's linked to all kinds of other open data sets on the web. And it's also readable by machines, which is a really important thing in today's Google search, Alexa environment. So what's in Wikidata? So like Wikipedia, it's kind of encyclopedic in its scope, but because it's crowdsourced, there's all kinds of variations in what's covered in Wikidata and what's not covered. So this is a pie chart. This is actually, it pulls data from the early 2020, back when there was only about 71 million data items in Wikidata. And it kind of grouped what's in Wikidata by category. And so you can see the biggest chunk of the pie is taken up by scholarly articles. And then human beings occupy about 8% of the pie. And then astronomical objects occupy about 6% of the pie. And then after that, it's just a whole bunch of different miscellaneous stuff. So the fact that there's 6% astronomical objects reflects the fact that enthusiasts of astronomical objects got together and coordinated their efforts and figured out how to add all kinds of items into Wikidata. So that's the kind of thing that we're looking at going forward, IOI and its wider community. If it's interested in using Wikidata as a knowledge base, it would need to organize itself in a similar way and coordinate how it edits Wikidata. So in my study, I wanted to sort of think about, well, what's of interest to IOI? What are its concerns? So I tried to narrow down the field a little bit, and I started just with a small group of examples. And I tried to choose examples that already had a little bit of literature to them so that I could cite them in Wikidata. And then also I wanted to choose things that were relevant to IOI and its mission. So in 2020, Spark Europe and IOI put together a series of 10 interviews with open infrastructure components and the people behind them. And it specifically focused on the investment story of each one. So I thought that would be, you know, a good little sample, not scientific at all, but, you know, just something to start with. And so I sort of took those stories and the facts in them, sort of how was this founded? How was it developed? What kind of software were they focused on? What kind of grants did they get? You know, did they go commercial? Did they go nonprofit? What's their business model? That kind of thing. And then I just started poking around in Wikidata to see, well, huh, how much of what's already in Wikidata is represented? So I put together a bunch of lists on Wikidata. So you, as sort of a person who's not affiliated with my particular project, you can go to Wikidata and look at this stuff. It's all transparent. Everything I did was transparent and in sort of real time. So you can see all my edit history since September. So this is one list that I put together. This was just a list of data categories that were common to all of the 10 examples when I started in September. And then through the course of my study, I edited each of the 10 items and added in information that I thought would be useful to IOI and its stakeholders. So what I found, I put together in a list also on Wiki, and let's just go there now live. I hope you can all see this. So this is, it's a long list, and I tried to chunk it in terms of products, services, and technology, and then the organizations that produce those products, and then also anything related to investment or financials or funds. It's just an accumulation. So you can see, I'll just scroll through quickly, long list. And get this out of the way. So you can see, these are just some on the left-hand side, there's just a sample of data categories related to products and services. So one example would be P1547, which is how Wikidata calls things. It doesn't call them by language, it calls them by this alphanumeric identifier. So if a particular component of open infrastructure depends on a particular software, you can add that into Wikidata. And then you can query it later. So you can say, like, give me all the open science tools that depend on Java. And you can say, give me all the open science tools and the name of the developer that developed it. So developer, you can say it's different from, so Figshare, the organization, is different from Figshare, the product, that kind of thing. And there's quite a few of these. And they're all kind of interesting. And I'm hoping that the IOI and its wider community would want to talk about these later. That would be a wonderful thing. So similarly, you've got data properties on the one hand, and then you've got items on the other, which is like data values. So you could say that something is an instance of free and open source software. You could say something is an instance of open science tool. And you could say something is used for peer review, for instance. So similar list for organizations, similar list with items for organizations. And so the implications for IOI of what I found is that there's a lot of components of the open infrastructure landscape that are indeed represented in Wikidata, but it's kind of scattered. and it's not necessarily consistent. And it's really important in a knowledge base for things to be consistent, because then you can query the knowledge base and get data out. So if it's scattered around, it's harder to find. So here's an example of the Wikidata query interface. This is one way to extract information out of Wikidata. And so this particular query, it's written in the Sparkle query language, and I've asked it to return open science tools and how they're used. So I'll just run the query now. This is live Wikidata that we're looking at. I hope you can all see this. So this is a list. There's 20 in this list. And we know these are open science tools because some editor has gone in the past and added that these are open science tools. And this use label, again, it's kind of a value judgment. So somebody has to know enough about DEPSI to say that it's used for credit, or you have to know something about R markdown to say that it's used for literate programming. But I think you could imagine, for IOI's purposes, this could be useful going forward for stakeholders that have questions about what to invest in, what it does, what its context is, that kind of thing. So I'll just close these windows, go back to the presentation. So another implication for how information is in Wikidata and what are the gaps is in Wikipedia, there's all kinds of different language Wikipedias, which I'm sure you all know. This one in particular is the Russian Wikipedia article for the French publisher EDP Sciences. And you can see on the right-hand side, there's an info box. And so each language Wikipedia has its own community, and together each community decides whether or not they want to use Wikidata to auto-populate their info boxes in Wikipedia. And so the Russian Wikipedians have gotten together and said, yes, we'd like to do that. So if I update something in Wikidata for EDP Sciences working in English, it automatically populates in the Russian Wikipedia article for it. So you can see there's information here about the date of founding, the address, the name of the director, Agnes Henry, the URL. So a more recent example, this is the multinational publisher Wiley. And this is the Ukrainian Wikipedia article for Wiley. And you can see there's this big red arrow pointing to Knowledge Unlatched. And this, again, this draws directly from Wikidata. And we know that Knowledge Unlatched was bought by Wiley. So I added this to Wikidata in a fit of emotion last week. And there it is. Now the readers of Ukrainian Wikipedia have this up-to-date information. This isn't yet a feature so much in English Wikipedia, but it hopefully will be very soon. So again, this isn't just another visualization of what's in Wikidata. This is for the publisher, the outfit Knowledge Unlatched. And you can see there's all kinds of components that describe it, including the fact that it's owned by Wiley now. So same thing, this is our research. You can see all kinds of facts about it that are visualized, like the founder. Here you see a little picture of Heather and Jason. And then up here, there's some logos for some of the funders that have supported our research over time. So recommendations for IOI going forward. I would recommend that IOI or somebody facilitate some sort of training, basic editing of Wikidata, how to use the Sparkle query language, how to propose a property, that kind of thing. I definitely recommend a sort of community-wide conversation in what terms and concepts are most important and how do we represent them in Wikidata? What do they mean? It's important to coordinate agreement on that. And ways to organize work on Wikidata include wiki projects, which are a convention for organizing work on wiki. Focus list is another one. And then sort of typical events like edit-a-thons. So that's it for me. And I hope if you have questions, you'll pipe up. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. Do we want to save questions towards the end, or we can also spend some time now if folks have questions they would like to raise?
I'm happy to wait till both folks go through the presentation.
Okay, great. So without further ado, Teri, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Katie. I'm just going to share this. Hello, everyone, for those who may have joined in after. So the purpose of my research was to find out if what would be the impact of the government on the adoption of open technology infrastructure. And I picked open technology infrastructure as a broad base. So it could be either hardware or software. It really depended on what I was going to find when I was to speak with some of the technology professionals. And to begin with, here is what kind of to expect. So how I went about this study is I started with listing down why I chose this study. I used China's inspiration, seeing how the government really dictates how private sector invests in various things, whether it's technology. We've looked at solar energy, so solar technology, battery technology. The government says we want to see significant advancements. The private sector invest like 100% of their R&D into it because they know that the government is behind it in terms of policy, subsidies, is going to have to get a market. So that really helps lower the cost of things. So over the past few years, you've seen lower costs in things like a decentralization technology, Bitcoin mining, you've seen solar tech and battery tech. So I wanted to see if all governments took a similar approach to open infrastructure. Invest in it, whether it's just take an interest, invest in it, support it, would that lower the cost or make it stable enough that people will be able to consider it? The people in SMEs can compete with the likes of Oracle and Microsoft at a level playing field because now it's really a matter of skill and service and not the cost of acquisition and, you know, overall cost of ownership when we look at this. So for the purpose of this report, I'll just showcase a brief overview of things. Please let me know if it's too small. I can zoom in to certain sections. Just unmute yourself and tell me, hey, I can't see it, and then I'll adjust. So I'll start with the preface forward introduction in the top sheet. We'll mostly be stopping at the top sheet, mainly because a lot of the contents on the others, when I spoke with the interviewees, they wanted to see what was in the report before they approve it. And I'm going to be sending each of them a specific version of it only with their content. Of course, general findings, but we have a section where we profile everyone. So once they approve everything, then I can share that links and everything with the entirety of IOI and they can go through it and that will be the final report. So I'm gonna start, this is the start here one. And we look at a few things in the preface, a few notable quotes from notable people, I guess. Open source is industry separate model, the future will be built on open infrastructure, the future of America depends on open source tech. So this is really the direction that we're going. And we saw a very big shift when Microsoft, of all people, decided it's going to partner up with open source, something we thought we would never, ever, ever see in the history. Like in all the years I've known them, it was unprecedented. So if we're looking at that from the industry leaders, like this would be maybe the kind of incentive or the kind of pivot that would help other governments go through it. So this is a summary of what we talked about, what my inspiration for that was. It was China. And I wanted to see if we can do the same thing with open infrastructure that they do with everything in terms of their own country management. So the context is open infrastructure powers everything in some way or form. Someone comes and finds free code on the internet or free or patent-free infrastructure, builds around it, commercializes it and then moves on. So despite all that, something like Zoom having so much open infrastructure, there simply isn't enough funding for it. Like people come, they fork, they take whatever they want and then they leave the open source, open infrastructure community with nothing. So even the recent landscape study by IOI concluded that, you know, this is an issue. Most of them are really underfunded, they're understaffed and they're at the brink of closing. So my objective was just to understand all these professionals, like what do they use? Proprietary or open infrastructure? What are the drivers in what they use? How do they decide? The challenges they face on both fronts, what they think about the government involvement, and then develop recommendations from that based on what they think should be done. So there's a literature review where I just explore other reports, and then I conducted 10 plus interviews with practitioners. We're gonna see one example of those interviews a little bit later. So here's where I want us to spend most of our time. The top shoot on what it is we did. So this is the background on the study commissioned by Open Infrastructure, together with Code, the Center for Society, and Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. And what we found for majority of them is that, yes, they think the government should definitely get involved with Open Infrastructure. There was only one definitive no, but all the rest were a solid yes. So the involvement was going to be in the form of adoption. So the government should not dictate what private industries do. The government themselves and its institutions would use Open Infrastructure. And then after that, they would require other institutions to plug in and do that. So if you want to work with the government, same thing, government buys Cisco. Anyone who wants to work with the government has to have a Cisco certification, et cetera. So the government adopted Open Infrastructure. Anyone who wants to work with them has to have Open Infrastructure on their side as well, which would increase the usability, utility, and all that. Awareness, public benefits of Open Infrastructure. There's a perception in the user's mind that when something is open, you don't need to pay for it. And if you don't pay for it, it's not a quality thing. So they're going to need to create that kind of awareness to change people's minds. And when it comes to funding, subsidies for anyone who wants to invest. Well, because something is open, someone has to pay for it. You know, someone getting more means someone is getting less somewhere. There's always someone who has to pay for something. So the impact of this this involvement would be, this is how they should be involved. The impact would be greater awareness, better quality of software. You know, more money means better experts, better tech, better infrastructure means less maintenance, more use, which will spur innovation because it's lower cost of infrastructure, people can afford it, SMEs, et cetera, mass adoption. Government is the biggest buyer of anything. Their purchases and trends the market. If the government decides we're all Microsoft, everyone has to go to Microsoft to work with government. And then increased experts. More open source means, you know, everyone has to learn open source the same way there was more Windows penetration in like Kenya, for example. Schools started teaching Microsoft certifications and all that. There are challenges. Migration, for example. Moving to open infrastructure, they want things to break, and citizens don't care what the government is using, they just care that it works. You want your e-citizenship or your social security number, whatever it is you're doing for the government, you want it to work day one. It's not really the average citizen's concern how it works. Consolidation. So which open infrastructure do you focus on? Who is going to own this IP? So if you leave it open, someone comes and forks it and then starts a legal battle with the government. If you leave it closed, it means people have to either pay the government or get permission to use it. So there's a really tricky balance of exactly how they're gonna do it. And how would this change, survive change administration? The new president comes in, like, will they remain committed to this kind of shift towards open? So, possible solutions, standardization of frameworks, platforms, components, a sort of ISO, country-specific ISO for all these kinds of open infrastructure, ownership, so unite everything under one intellectual property umbrella for government. So we can say, for example, like this is a Kenya umbrella for all open infrastructure used by every business or organization looking to operate within the border, so to avoid legal issues. Of course, more awareness and funding, helping SMEs and startups compete. Because right now, the cost of getting started is so high that the average citizen who has maybe a better product offering is unable to compete because of all the licenses and registrations that they have to do. When we looked at the participants, conducted interviews with professionals across the following fields, everything from cloud, gaming, AI, decentralized applications, head tech, urban, this is urban planning, government, and mobility. So when we did that, One of the things we found is this technology. 17% use commercial infrastructure exclusively, 25% open infrastructure exclusively, but majority use a bit of both. So what we will be exploring in this is that when they're using this, what is the need? Like, what need drove this use? How did they identify it? How did they acquire it? How did they implement it? What are the procedures around the implementation of it? Because there's some that are guided by company ICT, or often it's the lead consultant. So you go to a client, they have no idea how to install this, so they defer to the client or the specialist to do it. Laws and regulations, majority is country and data protection laws. So things like GDPR, especially for a country like Kenya that is well versed with, it has, you know, EU citizens and the government will really come for you if you do that. So the rest of the report, once completed, will follow this kind of format. So technology being used, what are the benefits and challenges? How do you maintain it? So those in commercial, how do you maintain it? How is it funded? Who is involved? Who is in charge? How are they paid? Things like that. And open infrastructure, like what are their thoughts around in terms of development, distribution, and funding? And then finally, at the end, we're getting towards the end, I'll have a list of all the questions that I used to determine the study. And after that, this is the part that I'm working on at the moment, is profiles for each individual. Some of them requested such profiles to be at the end, so they can get to read a transcript of what it is they talked about, and then we can publish. So this is an example of the person who said no. Let me zoom in a bit so the icons are clearer. So I designed it in such a way that you know who it is, where they work, and a quick summary of exactly what to expect. So they use cloud and cloud tech commercial. They think I should get involved. They want improved IP regulation and help SMEs better compete. So these iconography will show an example of what would be in the summary. So as I finish all this, I'll be working backwards. I'll finish all the profiles of everyone, and then I use the summaries to determine how to create these other earlier sections that you saw that we would need to populate. So the profile of each individual will go through what they said. There'll be areas with notable quotes, references at the bottom, so on and so forth. Page after page, each person is about maybe 6 pages. This was the longest interview. They were the most comprehensive, so I started with them, and it will set the baseline for how all the others will look. Yes, thank you so much, Katie, IOI board. Any questions? I don't know how we do the questions, but Katie, you let us know.
Great, thank you, Teri. Big round of applause for our fellows. wanted to open the floor for questions. And I'm happy to jump in while people warm up if folks don't have anything burning, but I wanted to provide that opportunity to everybody here. Don't be shy. Leslie.
Yeah, so.
And then Liz.
Lots of questions, but I'm not going to make sense. Wikidata, I have very, very little knowledge of here, you know, in terms of, you mentioned a little bit about the coverage. So obviously it's not designed for this kind of work, right? But there are interesting way that you are extracting information out of it. So I'm just trying to square the two things, right? So the kind of questions that you're interested in and whether this is the right kind of databases to get those answers, right? Because for example, I'm used to going into those business databases where you know loads and loads of these information on mergers and acquisitions and annual incomes and you know CEO salaries and all those kind of things. Would be interesting to kind of compare what you find on both, you know, contrast them. And then see how useful, Wikidata is for this kind of work. So I'm not sure if I'm making sense at all. So that's I'll stop there.
Thanks. That's a really helpful comment. I think one advantage of Wikidata is that anyone can edit it. And so if something doesn't happen to be in a conventional database, like the ones you mentioned, people can add it in. So it's very useful for emerging domains like open infrastructure. That was one of the big reasons why I thought it might be something to look into. I think if there were sort of off-the-shelf databases that covered open infrastructure, that would be great, but they're not always free to use. They're not always easy to reuse, and they certainly can't be easily edited in the way that Wikidata can be. But I there's also opportunity in Wikidata to link to external identifiers. So if a particular sort of common database has identifiers for each of its entries, that can be added into Wikidata. And so the machines then understand that the two are linked.
Yeah. So what got me thinking is, you know, as you said, a lot of these databases, they are not easy to access. They're close access. And but I've been trying to think about a way to actually liberate a lot of those data, because we've been tracking, you know, companies like Elsevier's and all those kind of things. There's huge amount of information. Some of them are actually on other open platforms, and they're just scattered, right? So, you know, I would want to look into the legality of extracting some of those data from some of these databases, because they are themselves compiled from other open databases, right? And so if we can somehow liberate some of those data and put into Wikidata for more open use, that would be pretty interesting. And I think this follow the money is very important, because so many of these acquisitions and so forth, the owners of these companies, you know, they just go to ultimately these venture capitalists, you know, fly-by-night firms. It would be nice to know who these people are and what they're investing in as well, along with these scholarly open infrastructures.
Agree. I know we had Liz up next, and then David, if that's okay.
Sure. Actually, my question was very similar to Leslie's, but maybe I'll ask it in a slightly different way, in a way that maybe will involve you to answer too, Kay. Because my question was around, you know, thinking about how the coverage of those data are you know, have gaps, and you probably know it best. So if you were to work with Kay or some, you know, someone joining the IOI team about where to start in terms of the kinds of questions that can be answered using those data, what would you say, where would you suggest for them to look first? Or ask first?
I'm so glad you asked. That question came up at the Open Publishing Fest. I ran a little session about Wikidata for open publishing tools. That same question came up. And so I put together a single page on Wiki Starter Guide with maybe, I don't know, 10 properties to start with. So it's included in the slides at the very end. And I can also, I can put the link in the chat as well. But it's, you know, it includes things like what's the name of the founder and what's the date of inception. And my personal favorite is pronunciation audio. So for products or organizations that have funky names, nobody knows how to pronounce them, like archive.org. Do you pronounce the X? is it a K? What is it? So it's helpful to have somebody record a little pronunciation audio. And then you can just link that in Wikidata. So then when somebody does a Google search, that'll pop up.
Okay, and question to you, Kay, then, if you were to, you know, if you had extra 2 hours tonight to do a query and to, like, you know, start with a research question, what would you start with?
So one of the things, and, you know, we have Richard and Asura here too, Liz, who are our two research data analysts. If you both want to wave. Wave. There we go. So you've got the whole IOI team here. So it's been fascinating because one of the things we thought was really interesting about this project is the information that Richard and Asura have been building out as sort of the foundational sort of knowledge base to hopefully be able to power our recommendations and the prototypes that I know Josh has been part of the focus groups for that we'll be sharing more about in the next week to 10 days is for that information. Some of that is pulled in through qualitative interviews. Some of that is pulled in through elements that may not necessarily meet the verification standards for incorporation in a wiki-based product, like Wikidata, like in terms of the citations that would be needed to point to. But we are very keenly aware of wanting to make that information publicly available so that, you know, as we build out a catalog of open infrastructure services, as we start to map those elements for where things are progressing in terms of ownership, in terms of usage, in terms of legal status, et cetera, you know, not only having our team be working on that, but also knowing where our gaps are in our own understanding and capacity. And so, you know, some of the work that Anne has done to show even just how to pull some of the information to see what might already exist, what might need to be updated. Also, there's a little bit of a future proofing of ensuring that we are not the bottlenecks of this information moving forward and that we can, you know, invest in resources that are propagating huge other open knowledge resources and also invite others to contribute to helping to move that forward. So I think on my end, as I'm getting to know Wikidata more, starting to see to what level of detail people have started to detail these projects. And in many of the cases, it is Anne who has gone through and like David's previous work in mapping the infrastructure landscape has already been sort of, and many of those sort of surveys been represented and put into Wikidata, but starting to see where there might be trends across of information that might not yet be included, which might help map into our future strategy or areas of contention and starting to understand where we can start to look for different signals in the space. I'm gonna hand it over to David, and then I know we've got some questions for Teri too. David, over to you.
Thank you. So I think in my mind, one of the key questions that IOI needs to start to try to figure out is how much does open infrastructure globally cost on an annual basis? So you can go back to various funders and say, it's $100 million, we have to collect it, here's your share. And I think the Wikidata data structure offers some opportunities. In my view, they're probably in the United States are somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 or 20 organizations that support the bulk of the open infrastructure that's outside of universities, which are pretty hard to track. But that data is generally 501c3s, so you can pull that data out of the 990 PFs. The tax documents that they have to file. So I think that looking at collecting that information on that 25 or 30 core institutions would get you a long way to the US infrastructure pieces. Europe's a lot harder because a lot of it's embedded in EU and other institutions, and other parts of the world are harder to sort out. And I don't know enough about Canada, but my assumption would be that there would be comparable pieces. And or you pull that out of like PKP has probably the best annual report of any organization in the sector. So I think you could get 80% of the North American dollars accounted for pretty much more easily than you think you might. The last 20% gets to be almost impossible, but you can get a long way with that. I think the Wikidata is a good structure because you can pull good financials out of the 990s. And, you know, right now you get at them through GuideStar, but it's not copyrightable information. So you could pull that 990 stuff right up and post it. And I think that'd be a really good project for IOI to try to piece together.
Thank you.
No question there, I guess.
I know I want to be conscious of time. And so maybe we can come back to that comment as well, because I do know we've got, Asura, you had flagged that you had a question for Teri. But David, that's a really good point that I know we want to circle back on. Go ahead, Asura.
Thanks again for both. I hope, are you guys hearing me? Yes. Thanks again for both presentations. I have a question for Teri. I know you're still going through the interviews, but for me, like, one thing that really stands out is the breadth of the interviews of kind of like the stakeholders and kind of like other folks, and kind of like I would describe them as allied spaces, especially when you mentioned urban planning and mobility. It was just really interesting to me that, and then so for context, I work out of Vancouver, and Vancouver's housing market is terrible, and urban planning is such a big topic that I end up having really interesting conversations with urban planners who are friends, who are very passionate and talk about infrastructure. And I often see this clash, which is interesting because it's like, oh yeah, I also work in infrastructure, but it's digital infrastructure. So I'm just like, my question is, have you seen so far in the interviews interesting overlaps for kind of like more classic infrastructure and especially advocacy, activism in that space, more progressive ideas, innovation that might be interesting for kind of like this, specifically the open scholarly infrastructure space?
Thanks for that, Asura. So what I've been seeing from the interviews, and there's one person I spoke with who actually built some of the government platforms that help youth and people with disabilities access government tenders. What I saw with them is when I asked them, what exactly do you think should happen to this? They said, one, government should definitely get involved. But two, the challenge with the government being involved is that they're not transparent. The biggest impact they'd want to see is the transparency on the government side, because a lot of these people do think that the government is working. They just think that it's doing a very poor job of showing the parts of it that work. And when it doesn't work, it's really, really highlighted. Like it's splashed all over the papers, et cetera. But when something is working, the government doesn't talk about it. So what I'm seeing with these people is they're saying that one, government should get involved. Two, it should be mostly around like policy and just enablement and not direct intervention. And then in the third one, it's just to be able to manage the whole process. I don't know if I've answered your question, or would you like to clarify?
Yeah, that sounds good. And especially you had mentioned some of these in your findings, but I do find sometimes wondering if the scholar community is kind of like reinventing the wheel, at least some efforts, because obviously the academic community isn't the only community facing issues around kind of like ownership of infrastructure, of services, reliability, sustainability. And I think you did answer the question. So especially just hearing that this is kind of like, thanks for just again pointing out that this kind of like government involvement seems to be a theme that came out of all the interviews. So that's just the thing where I was like, you had those 10 interviews, I don't remember the number, but like those interviews, and I would love to just kind of like, I was really curious about your gut feeling in terms of what is the takeaway message for us in the scholarly space?
The takeaway message is the government should get involved. Not all of them agree on how. Like for example, this one that I featured, the first one, does not want government involvement at all, because they think that when the government starts to meddle, perverse incentives come in. There is a, let me see. There was a section on it. When governments get involved, governments should not get involved because the moment they do, there are perverse incentives that come in. People now start, whoever is involved decides that, hey, I want to do it. We're going to do this. Smallest disagreement, they fork whatever it is and they go on their own. And we've seen that with something like the umbrella project for Verizon, Google, Microsoft, AWS. When they couldn't agree on what direction to take that project, Amazon forked out whatever it wanted. And then it said, to hell with the rest of you, we don't need you. We're going to make money without you. So, it's once I get done, I think I'll send you a summary as well, and then maybe we can discuss that. Because I can't send the summary part, it's these parts that I can't send. So like you see this, for example, it's not for governments to come here and say that you need to use open source. It's for governments to use open source software. They take the lead, the Ministry of Information Technology takes the lead and then tells everyone else, you wanna work with us, here's what happens. Like in the US, you wanna work with us, you can't be segregationist, you can't be racist, you don't have to do all these things. And so they comply. So the involvement is through example and not through strong arming a lot of the people to do it.
And I think that's a really important point, Teri, because I think it's sort of kind of a straw man to say, oh, government shouldn't get involved. Government's already involved. They fund a lot of research around the world. And so they're already involved. I think there's a particular type of involvement maybe that people are less welcoming, but there is definitely some involvement. And I think it also, as a scholarly community, understanding that most people in government, at particular levels of policymaking, don't have the faintest idea what gold access, green access, or all, you know, Plan S, all of these things. They just don't, they don't know. And so it's very easy then for the loudest voices to kind of hijack the conversation, and maybe, you know, certain actors in the field with more resources than others can dominate the discussion if there isn't the education about the types of actions and the things that the government people need to know, different mechanisms of government to achieve the desired results. So I'd be interested to know, like, what specifically when they say, you know, government shouldn't be involved, what they mean, and like what type of involvement is problematic, but also what type of involvement is really helpful in this space.
Teri, you might be muted. Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yes, so they believe in open market, like the free market. So the government should get involved by it itself taking ownership of open infrastructure and utilizing it. Oh, okay.
I just stopped your sharing so we could have the conversation. No worries, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, so they believe that the government should just set an example by using it and then start drawing interest from all the other people who are doing it. Because if you decide to say that I'll use Kenya for example, we are an open infrastructure community, end of story. What happens to all the investment that's been done by people like Oracle, Microsoft in terms of job creation, like funding universities, like scholarships for people, like all that suddenly is like looking wasted. What happens to the quality of life for citizens through like the use of like digital government services? So it's not forcing people with a blanket resolution that open infrastructure is what we should use, should not be the way to go. Government uses it, government gives incentives, commercial or otherwise. Government tells you as a, let's say like Richard Dunk's 21-year-old college graduate, hey, if you want to compete with Microsoft, we're gonna help you, we're gonna fund you, won't tax you for the first 3 or 5 years as long as you meet the following criteria, you're out the door. Anything you need, you have it. So then that creates better incentives for people, and it allows the progression of open infrastructure to be more natural, more organic, that people are taking it up because they see the value, and it's not because someone is forcing them to do it. There's a quote about, you should always let people do what they want. Then you see what they'd rather do instead of what you tell them to do. So that summarizes what this one who said absolutely not believes. Those who said yes are a bit on the fence around it. Some want the government to just come in and say, yeah, if you use it, we'll make life easier for you. Easier, cheaper, we'll fast track everything you want to do, we'll help you compete. Others believe that this should be something that's put in academics. Others believe that the government just simply says, hey, if you want to work on anything that is gonna be used in public access, you must use open infrastructure. So internally, you can use whatever you want, but if it has to trust the public, it must be open infrastructure. So when I'm done, the top sheet will be updated. So I'm working backwards and then we'll see what everyone says. And hopefully everyone all the interviewees agree that I can include their findings here after I give it to them so that it's all cohesive and I don't change.
Thank you for that, Teri. I know we're right at the top of the hour, very quickly to that. Just as a quick comment before thanking our fellows and for you all for joining in these presentations. I think also, Teri, I'm so glad that you explored this work in the way that you did. I think one thing that might not necessarily be obvious, because I know that we didn't share sort of all the participant lists of the people that Teri was interviewing, but also the situational context and the local context of these individuals being largely from the African continent and from East Africa in particular. And so there's additional elements there that are really important as we start to explore the ways in which we can sort of decenter some of the North American focus of IOI's work and better understand what those implications may look like. And I think that the trust in government is something that is, you know, in many cases, somewhat universal, or at least you could find that pocket, but it does take on different contexts when you think about it with some of the different places that the participants are reflected from. Also worth noting that in terms of the review process that Teri is going through with the participants, it has been incredibly informative on our end about how to ensure that we're not being extractive of the knowledge and contributions from those that are participating. And we've had some very open discussions about how we can support that and having that review process and other sorts of elements open for those participants based on, again, some historical experience with those from the Western world, you know, and the ways in which they've been asked to participate in research previously as well. So more to come on that. Huge thanks to Teri and to Anne for sharing this work. Both incredibly useful in advancing our understanding and our strategies moving forward. We are so grateful for the depth of work and the commitment that you've put forward. And also our huge thanks to the Sloan Foundation for giving us the opportunity to bring on some additional support in this space and to help accelerate our work and our understanding of the sector. So please join me in a giant round of applause for Anne and for Teri. And we'll share this out with the broader steering committee and also with Liz and with Josh as well. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of your afternoon.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Hey, everybody. Bye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Katie?